This is Jon Swasey, the voice of Gendo Ikari from Evangelion, and you're listening to the Third Impact Anime Podcast. Now get in the effing robot.
Folks, this is Austin here, just dropping by real quick to let you guys know that unfortunately I was not able to make it to the recording of this particular podcast episode where some of the folks in Third Impact chat about going to Anime Week in Atlanta a couple of weeks ago. I had a quick thing that I had to take care of in that moment that prevented me from attending the recording session, but all is well, and I just wanted to pop on here real quick and thank you guys for listening to this episode. I know we haven't really put out a podcast episode in kind of a little while, and that's because of just us being very busy as of late and of convention season wrapping up and all of that sort of stuff, and Anime Week in Atlanta preparation keeping us really busy. Work on panels and whatnot, because we had a really, really large lineup spread out over all of us. We had a lot of panels to work on and not a whole lot of time to dedicate to recording the podcast and watching shows and getting ready for that, because it does take a lot of preparation to get these things out sometimes. But I did want to say thank you guys for your patience. We really appreciate it, and I hope you guys enjoy this episode, and Ryan and Marisa and Tobias and the crew will talk more about Anime Week in Atlanta from their perspective, but I did just want to say just a big general thank you to everyone that came out to at least my panels in particular, and all of the Third Impact panels in general. Thank you guys so, so much for coming out. We really do appreciate it, and just wanted to give a shout out to all the other wonderful panelists and other people that were there at the convention. Got to meet so many fantastic, excellent, interesting people and spend some time with them at the con, and got to see some really amazing panels from some very talented people from all over the country, and it was a truly amazing experience, very uplifting, very inspiring, and that's sort of what Anime Weekend Atlanta is all about for us in so many different ways. So again, really appreciate it, and I hope you guys enjoy this episode, and we will be back with another anime review coming up here in just a couple of weeks, hopefully maybe under a week. We'll have another episode out for you guys, and then hopefully now, since convention season is sort of concluded for us for the year, we can spend the fall and winter season sort of recouping and doing some more anime reviews for you guys. So thank you for staying in. Thank you for staying tuned in, and we will see you in the next one.
Hi, everybody, and welcome to the Third Impact Anime Podcast. I am your host for this week, Ryan. I'll be filling in for Austin. He's a little busy right now trying to wrestle a kangaroo to the ground in an attempted display of dominance, and we all wish you the best in your endeavors, Austin.
Yeah.
So this week, we're going to be talking about our recent excursion to Anime Weekend Atlanta, located in sunny Sarasota, Florida. And today with me, I have John.
Hello.
That's a very, very exuberant welcome greeting, John.
So, considering how sick I am, yes.
Yeah. Yeah, John's a little sick. I've also got Andrew with me.
What's up?
I got a question.
Tan from Florida.
Okay, yeah, that's good. I got a question for you. Mm-hmm. Why is Austin trying to wrestle a kangaroo, and where did he get a kangaroo that isn't in Australia?
Well, it stole his lunch money. It punched him right in the booty, and then it stole his lunch money, so he had to go and wrestle it to get back its lunch money that it took away in its pouch. So,
I get that. And I also have Tobias.
Hey.
How you doing?
I'm here. I'm present.
You are present.
I am the present.
You are the present. You are the present to this podcast.
You're welcome.
And last but certainly not least, hello, Marisa. How are you?
Hi. I'm kind of tired.
Yeah.
I've been attacked by mosquitoes. I don't know how. Don't ask me. Just don't. My doctor is baffled as well. I don't know how I got eaten alive by mosquitoes in the middle of Atlanta, but I did.
John, I told you to cage the mosquitoes after we left.
Oh. I thought you said cage the machines, not the mosquitoes. My bad. Well, and even that doesn't make sense because I should have been raging against the machines. Man, my hearing just sucks nowadays.
Join the club.
Well, yeah. Thank you all for joining me today. So as I mentioned, we all took a trip to Anime Week in Atlanta, and I actually was just given a note by our producer that it was not taking place in sunny Sarasota, Florida, unfortunately, because I don't know where the heck I was then. It actually took place in Atlanta, Georgia, which in all honesty makes more sense. But yeah, so this con had about 29,000 attendees, which for me personally is the biggest con I've ever been to, which was even more terrifying because I was doing podcasts, panels, both old and new. So we all did panels, I think, at least most of us did. John, I know you volunteered. Do you want to talk about how that was?
Sure. Compared to last year, it was a lot slower. I got really spoiled last year and kind of lucked into working the grand panel room and working with their lighting guy, Enda, who's just a treasure. I love him. But last year was pretty fun because I actually got to run a lot of the panel rooms and deal with the soundboard a lot, talk to a lot of the people in the industry. Like I was doing the Crunchyroll panel for their new premieres coming out that year. I did the Funimation panel, which I think was like a peep show of some sort, which was fine, I suppose. Did a really cool dance party kind of thing later that night. And I also had the pleasure of working with Faku, which was definitely memorable.
I'm like still wondering why they invited Faku of all things.
I know
they're big now, but I always remember them as the Dojin site from my days on 4chan.
Oh, they were just wanting to let everybody know that they were just expanding beyond that and showed some wonderful examples of some of the material they were showing. So,
are these PG examples or?
No, probably none that I can repeat here.
But, I was going to say, John, you should never mention expansion in the terms of pornography.
I mean, you're not wrong, but compared to some of the other stuff that I heard and saw, expansion is relatively tame.
Yeah, but, pretty much.
This year was a little slower. I didn't have quite as much to do. I wasn't assigned to any panel rooms to really work with, so it was kind of interesting. We had a lot of people volunteer this year for tech, especially. They turned me away Friday morning. Or was it Thursday morning? Thursday morning, they turned me away and told me to come back at 4. So that didn't happen last year. I just kind of walked in there like, oh, thank God you're here. You're going to be doing gaffing for the next 4 hours. Awesome. So had some more serious issues. I know when the room that they had the DJs in wasn't exactly the best room to put them in. And we ended up losing a couple speakers and like an amp just blew them up. So had some pretty substantial issues, but it was fine. Managed to work another 13-hour shift this year, and that was interesting. That was interesting. Like I got to work with Enda again, which was awesome.
That's cool.
But and apparently he actually works at the Queen City Con, so I may be working with him next year. Yeah, that'll be kind of fun. I'm looking forward to that.
That's a kind of a big comparison going from Anime Week in Atlanta to Queen City.
Yeah, right?
Yeah. One of those is significantly larger than the other.
Listen, if I can work with him, that's fine. I'll go anywhere.
Yeah, sure.
So I started working at 5 p.m. on Saturday, and I got back to the hotel room at 6:15 on Sunday a.m.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Yeah, yes. Then we had to wake up to like pack up and leave. Like on Sunday, I was hiding from the crew because I'm like, I don't want to work anymore. I just want to go home.
Yeah, I was your meat shield for that.
You all are my meat shield, and I appreciate that very much. Thank you.
Surround John, protect him from work.
Mm-hmm. So, I worked about as much as I did last year. Well, as far as hours went, I didn't work quite as much, didn't do nearly as much gaffing, thank goodness. But,
Yeah,
I wouldn't say it was worse. I would just say it was very different compared to last year.
Would you do it again?
Yeah, I'm planning to do it next year, and I may even expand to some more cons next year as well. So we'll see.
I mean, you know, John, it's never not working.
Yeah, when we eventually have Third Impact Con, you're going to be the main tech lead, so get ready.
I mean, only I would take off time from work to work.
That's true. Yeah, that is true. So, I don't know about the rest of you, but this personally was my first, like, big road trip con. Like, it was my first out-of-state one. So, it was a pretty big deal for me. Marisa, Will, Edwin, and I all packed into, or actually, more accurately, Edwin and Will packed into my car with me. We drove down to Marissa's, picked her up, packed into her car, and drove down to Atlanta.
My car is a TARDIS.
Yeah, her car is a TARDIS. She could fit everything.
Wow.
So, yeah, so we had a lot of fun on our way down. It was a 6-hour drive, roughly, and it honestly flew by because we were all just having a lot of fun in the car together, and it was cool. I love road trips personally, so it was not a chore for me. But so when we got there, Thursday, the first thing we did was we set up a stall for the flea market, or I'm sorry, as they call it, the Super Happy Fun Sale, which is the flea market. And we sold a ton of our old nerdy swag that we needed to get rid of and bought pretty much just as much to replace the stuff we sold.
Bought just as much.
Yes, I bought just as much. I went a little crazy, but I actually am like kind of happy about some of the things I got. One of the things I got that was kind of cool is Edwin, on the way down, we were talking about Detective Pikachu, and he's like, yeah, I really want the amiibo, but they're like really expensive. I only see them for about $35. And so I was like, man, that sucks. Like, I really wish you could get that so your sister could play the DLC and you'd have this really cool Detective Pikachu amiibo that's like really big in person also. It's like double size any other amiibo. So I was going around these stalls, taking a break from selling my stuff, and I see a Detective Pikachu amiibo just sitting there, and I was like, oh, shoot. Well, I may as well ask them how much. And they said $10, and I immediately was just like, sold. And I walked over to Edwin and handed it to him, and he was like, oh my god, thank you. So he gave me Mario Party 3 for it.
Nice.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry.
That among like a few other things he owed me for, but like, yeah. Also, I found a boxed copy of Fire Emblem for $5, which I was just floored about.
What?
I found figures of my son, which is Rowlet, in case you don't know. And I bought a Dreamcast for $20, so I did pretty well. The funniest thing, though, is we were talking to this one guy in line before we actually went in, and he had a set of Dragon Balls, and I kind of wanted them, but at the same time, I knew I shouldn't spend the money on them. I wound up not spending the money on them, but like one of his friends was also doing what we were doing in that he was splitting the table. And also, it's supposed to be like $35 for a table, and it's for one person. We had four people crammed onto one table, so it was kind of chaotic, but it worked, and we all made money. So I go over to this guy's friend, and I see he has a case for New Super Mario Brothers for Wii, which I need a case for because my label is torn. And I'm just like, hey, how much for this game? And he's like, you know, man, I would sell that to you, but I don't have the game for it anymore. It's just a case. And I was like, oh, that's perfect. I just need the case. How much? And everybody around us just starts dying laughing. And I bought it from him for $1, and everybody just started cheering because it was the guy's first sale, and he was really happy.
Wow.
So it was a fun time.
It was chaotic.
Yeah, it was chaotic.
Quite frank, comparing it to the flea market at Ichi and Triad Small, this was just utter chaos. We thought we would actually have some downtime to sit and kind of like relax a little bit because we had just driven up there like the day before, and no, we were on our feet the entire time.
Oh yeah,
selling stuff to people, trying to get people to buy things, and it was a madhouse until like it closed at 9, but they like extended it a couple of minutes. I think it went even to like 9:30.
It went to 9:30. I think 9 was actually a miscommunication because they didn't even say 15-minute warning until it was 9:15.
Yeah, but yeah, it went really late. They might have cut the line at 9, like no one else could come in after 9, and then
that may have been it.
You had 30 minutes to finish everything up, and then they kicked everyone out, but it was crazy.
Yeah, I sold pretty much all of the Monster Hunter figures I came with. I sold a bunch of games, I sold just a bunch of stuff in general, which I was really glad to finally get rid of. And you sold quite a few things as well, didn't you?
I did. I unfortunately didn't. Well, the only big thing I'll say was I sold a wall scroll, but I didn't sell as much of the bigger things like books and stuff that I wanted to. I sold a ton of my little keychain merch, which still helped, but I wanted to get rid of that manga. I just did. But no, my manga came back home with me, and yeah.
Yeah, I came back home with most of my manga and a few of my games, but not that much, thankfully, but there'll be other sales and we can get rid of it. But yeah, Tobias, I know you came kind of towards the tail end of that. Did you actually get much of a chance to really explore it?
Yeah, I looked around, but I'm not really in a bunch of a buy-in mood for the most part. So I just kind of looked around. The really cool thing about the Super Happy Fun Sale as compared to other, you know, taco flea markets like we have up here, since there's a bit of an older crowd, you see a lot more older vintage stuff present.
Yeah.
And there's definitely a lot of gems. So, like, I came in too late to really get anything really good. But I saw a lot of people on Twitter, like, talk about their own personal purchases. And like, we had, like, you know, Neil Native up at the front selling a bunch of old Laserdisc. There was one guy selling an almost complete collection of Tezuka's Phoenix manga, which I almost jumped in on, but I wanted to save the cash. One dude picked up a replica Cosmo Dragoon, Captain Harlock's pistol, a water gun of the Cosmo Dragoon, and that was really cool looking. I wish I'd caught that. But I saw a few people walk around with like statues from like, you know, Lum or Sayatsura. And from what I did see jumping in late, there was a couple really good VHS collections. Some people had some old Animericas and new type. So I mean, you kind of had to dig a little bit, but there were a couple of hidden gems that I think stood out a little more than your standard, you know, otaku flea market, which is more like DVDs that no one really wants and manga that nobody remembers.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, it was kind of sad that I didn't get to go, since I didn't get down until sort of Friday afternoon / evening. Because
yeah, you got in really late. Kind of
I did. And I drove down by myself, which was a fun time.
Yeah. It's kind of like a bit of a double-edged sword. Like, I liked that it was earlier because I got to get rid of all the stuff I came with immediately and made money to then blow in the dealer's room.
Right.
So it was nice in that regard, but also I did enjoy at Triad and Ichi, like, just kind of decompressing with the flea market. But in all honesty, I made significantly more here than I've ever made at Ichi or Triad, so I'll take it. Easily. But yeah, hopefully you'll be able to go next year, because it was a lot of fun. I enjoyed it a lot. It was a good memory. But yeah, so getting into the rest of the weekend after that, pretty much all of us did a couple panels. Myself, I did Japanese culture and video games and the anime that saved anime. Tobias, what did you do?
I started off with art of paneling, and then I did Tape Tsunami Teenagers, and then Trigger Warning on Friday. On Saturday, I just did older anime for new fans. And on Sunday, I had three. Before Devilman Crybaby, and then the 2000s panel, and then ended the entire convention with Beyond Miyazaki.
Yeah, that was with you in Austin. That was a really good one.
Yep. I think it was really good, like a end to everything.
Yeah, and Marisa and I actually debuted our first ensemble panel together called Batman in Japan, and we were very, very happy about that. Do you want to speak about that a little bit?
Well, I want to know what's that panel about?
Okay. Well, it's about Batman in Japan.
Wait, he went to Japan?
Yeah. Marisa, go ahead and give a brief description of what it is.
All right. So it was kind of just like an entire panel on the media and that Japan kind of produced and his representation in Japan as a whole. So the two of us are big Batman and Batfam fans. So it was just kind of another way of us kind of nerding out about one of our favorite superheroes in the context of Japan, especially when it came to, because of the recent release of Batman Ninja, really spurned a lot of like interest in Batman in Japan.
Yeah, because we had always known that Bat manga existed, and we knew about Gotham Knight and how it was like, you know, the Batman anime film because it was done by anime studios. And we actually did a previous podcast episode about that. So if you want our in-depth thoughts about that and Batman Ninja, go check it out. We'll put a link in the description or something. And it was a lot of fun. We got one of the tiny rooms, unfortunately, for it, probably because it was a new panel. But we filled it past capacity, which I count as a complete win.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Like, I was very happy with the turnout. Everybody seemed to enjoy it a ton. And, like, we had a ton of fun doing it. But besides Batman in Japan, what other panels did you do,
Marisa? Me? Oh, yeah. I did my Token Rambu Behind the Blade panel again. I don't know how many times I've done it so far, but this is the first time I've done it, obviously, at AWA. And I also did my Super Shimada Bros. For those of you who came out to my Super Shimada Bros panel, I horridly apologize once more. I got, like I mentioned before at the beginning of the podcast, I got attacked horribly by mosquitoes all over my arms. I was having an allergic reaction to it. I had to go to the doctor when I got home, and he had to give me, like, topical steroid. It was not good. I couldn't move without really feeling pain all over my arms. So I was, like, done on Benadryl at that time because I just needed to. And it was 10:30 at night.
Yeah, so, that, and you also got screwed on the scheduling because they accidentally overlapped her with a horror panel in the exact same room.
I was supposed to be at 7:45, and then I noticed I wasn't on the schedule, but I was on the online schedule. And then we had to go talk to ConOps, and they're like, well, snap, they're already in there. Let's do 10:30 at the same day. And I was like, okay, I've never done a panel after 9 o'clock at night. Let's see how this goes.
Yeah.
So, but, yeah. That was...
Even though, like, I looked at all of the reviews on our panels on the guidebook app, and we all had at least 4 stars on every single one of our panels. So go us, like, round of applause. We did a really good job. Yeah, I was very happy with how we did. And everybody just knocked it out of the park. I saw a couple of ours. I saw a couple that weren't ours, actually. Were there any panels that any of you went to that weren't a Third Impact panel that you particularly liked?
Anime Hell.
Yeah.
I love
it. How was that this year? I didn't actually get a chance to go.
That was incredible. You talk more about that, Tobias. You've been more than I have.
Well, I mean, I go every year. So that's my shtick. And I don't really count it as a panel. It's just an experience. But this is your first time, right?
Yeah.
So yeah, like what from a newcomer's perspective, what did you think of Totally Lame and Anime Hell?
Totally Lame was extremely fun. And Anime Hell was also extremely fun. Chargeman Ken is my waifu now. Zaizen, wait, what's his name?
Jotaro.
Zaizen Jotaro.
He's
also my waifu now. Yeah. And, you know, he's got a bomb in his head. I'm sorry, doctor. Then drops him out of the bottom of the ship. Yeah, I thoroughly enjoyed both of those panels because I love that sort of weird, old,
just outright ridiculous humor.
Outright ridiculous humor and just like bad.
Well, it's really cool because there's stuff that you don't really. I know that Animazement does it, but it's really a different thing altogether. Like
I don't like Animazement's Anime Hell at all.
I have a. Sometimes it's good. Sometimes it's not great. But it is always a different experience than the one that Dave runs at AWA here. It's really more of an older, like retrospective kind of thing. Yeah, this year he brought back his comparison where he compared every year from like Western cartoons to like anime. Like the whole shitty talking dark show, show, compared to like we were getting like that. They were getting like, you know, Mazinger and Macross and that kind of stuff. Really awesome stuff.
Yeah.
The thing I really like about Totally Lame is all of that stuff that Neil archives is stuff that he's translated over time. So it's things that no one's really heard of. I think he was one of the first people to really bring into Garzy's wing into the memetic culture.
Oh my god.
I think that kind of happened all with a couple of people just, you know, commented on it at the same time. But I think he's one of the ones that kind of brought it into you know, the hive mind. That whole, what was it, like the whole Brave Frog thing with Miss Turtle died for a ping pong ball.
Oh yeah. Oh that, man. God, what was that show called? And like the frog mob boss.
Yeah.
God.
He brings a lot of the same content back every year, but he tries to bring up some new stuff, and it's stuff that you really don't get to see anywhere else. I really enjoy you know, his presentation of that.
Yeah, I probably enjoy his more than AZ's, but I didn't get a chance to go because I think we were busy with something else. I don't remember what we were doing, but yeah.
But to kind of comment on that, because I noticed you mentioned earlier about the small panel rooms. So in years prior, those small panel rooms weren't for panels. They were for other various administrative purposes. So they only had the 102 through 105 or 6. And like year after year, those panel rooms fill up. They cannot, you know, not put enough stuff on the schedule to not fill those panel rooms. So the fact that they even had those panel rooms open to do those ones that we did, like Batman, you know, like 2000s, like Art of Paneling,
yeah, and yet
to still have those still, you know, past capacity time and time again. The only panel room that didn't go over capacity was Art of Paneling because it was 9 a.m. on Friday. And it was already a niche of a niche. Like, I expected zero people to show up. Oh, but wow. I had about, like, 15, 20. So that was...
That's not bad.
Even, yeah, even then, that was a win for me. But, like, and you guys, I'm sure, experienced the same thing. Like, your panel was, like, filled up, like, time and time again, no matter what time it was on the schedule. And that's just, yeah, that's a thing that they can't really... There's no physical way for them to really get around that. The only other way would be to start putting panels late at night, which they did this year.
Yeah, they did. They did a lot of things late at night.
Like 3 a.m., 4 a.m. panels.
Yeah. The funniest thing that happened to me is I was getting ready to go into Anime That Saved Anime to, you know, do the panel. And so I saw that I had a line. I was like, oh, cool, I have a line. And so I, like, just walked to the front and tried to walk in because, you know, the panelist. And so this volunteer, who, god bless him, he was doing his job, but like he embarrassed himself so hard because he just like he tried to, like, you know, power trip just so nobody else would try to cut the line. He's like, whoa man, you can't cut the line, the line starts back there, this room is full. And I was like, yeah, this is my panel. And he just kind of like sheepishly moved aside and let me in. I was just like, you're doing your job, it's fine. But I thought it was funny. But
so yeah, as part of that, I do want to give a shout out to some of our fellow panelists that I see year after year. I want to give a shout out to NoS Anime that always does really great panels. I unfortunately couldn't actually really attend any because they all filled up as well, and they wouldn't let me, you know, hang out in the back. Same with all of your guys. Like I tried to go in there, but they wouldn't let me just hang out.
Yeah,
give a shout out to Richard Mongrel. See him year after year and always does really good stuff. Robert with Pokusachi. Again, really, really, really cool to see you guys again. Hope to see you guys next year as well. And yeah, of course, you know, Anime Hell was great. Dave Merrill was always runs really quality content, as well as Daryl Surat, which we got to hang out at Bet with this weekend, thanks to some hotel shenanigans.
Oh man.
Yeah. One panel I actually went to, Marisa went with me as well, and so did Will and Edwin. We went to Video Game Hell on Friday or Saturday night, was it?
Friday night.
It was the same Friday. Time slot.
Yeah, it was Friday. Okay.
Anime Hell.
Yeah, it was. That's right. That's why we didn't go. But we had so... Yeah, that too. We had so much fun with Video Game Hell. It was like trivia mixed with just cringe content of video games. And John, you would have appreciated it. Showed the worst of the worst of Mass Effect Andromeda.
It was beautiful.
Yeah, dang. It was so great. We were dying. And
it was like a 25-minute video, and they showed it at the beginning, and I was like, oh my god, we only got through like about a fourth or so of it, and I'm like, how much worse can this be?
Yeah. And Will and I dominated trivia, which was fun. But it was just a really fun panel. It actually inspired me to do one of my own at Ichi and Triad, which I just recently applied for. So hopefully I get that, because I would really like to do something like that. It was so much fun.
Awesome.
But Andrew, what else? What kind of stuff did you do, even though you came like later?
Well, I didn't do any panels because I honestly didn't know I was coming to AWA until last Tuesday. That was cool. So, you know, it was just sort of a last second trip for me. And my mentality living in Boone was like, well, I mean, I guess I could stay here all weekend, or I could drive to Atlanta by myself and hang out with my dumb friends. So I decided to drive to Atlanta and hang out with my dumb friends.
And I had
such a great time. I really, really did. Like, I was just happy to be there from like the moment I stepped foot in there. And it was a it seems like it is a bastion of old taku, which is really, really, really cool. It's very different from what we get up here, because we often get the industry guests we get are often not necessarily like the stalwarts of the fandom. And there was a lot of that at AWA, and it was super cool to see all that. I had a super, super awesome time.
Yeah, the guests for sure. We can get to them in a minute. But the one thing you mentioned that I want to touch on is you said it's just like we see a very different demographic than we see down here. Like, well, up here, rather. I had constantly been saying to all of you, and I'm sure you've heard me say this like a bunch of times, that I want to retire, at least temporarily, my Anime That Saved Anime panel, because I've done it so much. And like every time I do it, like something happens in it that just kind of sours me to doing it again, because somebody has a big mouth and has to say something that just kind of puts me off. And like this time, I didn't have any of that. This was the most like respectful audience I ever have done panels for. Nobody had like any obnoxious outbursts. Like everybody was respectful. Anything they had to say was constructive, or they actually wanted to know my opinion on something. And like, I just enjoyed doing it so much more. So I decided like, I'm not doing like controversial panels in North Carolina anymore, just because the audience doesn't know how to behave themselves. But like AWA, I'll do it in a heartbeat.
Yeah, I think that's a great observation. I think it's just it's sort of like I don't know if it's just because AWA is so much older than a lot of
the
times.
I think it's partly that.
But like, yeah, and it still has like that lingering sort of, how do I put this?
History?
That lingering history of like the culture prior, when it wasn't so mainstream and popular. It makes me sound like a hipster, but like, I mean, I honestly think that may be a reason why it is just so like focused.
Yeah, it could just be like the original thing. Because I mean, I feel like when I first started coming to Animazement, like before I lived here, I didn't really like Animazement at first. I kind of thought it was just kind of a goofy cosplay hangout con. It was only after a couple years of really enjoying it and doing panels that I really opened up to it. But I think there is definitely a different culture.
Yeah, because I don't know who it was that made mention of this, but AWA definitely is a lot more of a convention for like adults or older fans, because with AZ definitely, it's during Memorial Day. Like, there's a lot. Kids are off from school during that weekend, so they're able to travel. And AWA is like smack dab in the middle of the school year, and no one's going to want to let their kids, well, there's still kids that go, but they usually are only on the weekends and they're gone by like a certain time. It's not like a kids con. Like Ichiban's kind of become like this kids con a lot of the times, because I think just its location in Charlotte, but I'm not really certain. So that might be why it just had a different vibe, because there was more adults.
Yeah. Con. I just got to say, I really hope that North Carolina, like, fans in general, just, like, you got to be more respectful in panels. Like, not even in our own. Like, I've just noticed over the years, like, I just get so fed up with people who think that they can, like, domineer a panel. Like, I didn't see that at all at AWA, and I loved it so much more for it. But I think I interrupted Andrew.
Oh, no, it's fine. I was just going to make a joke about how much we hate children.
That's true. Yeah.
I mean, I would make that joke, but I'm hanging out with all you nerds, so.
Oh, thanks.
Jokes about my age. I know I'm the young, nubile infant of this entire podcast. I mean, my eyes are not yet revealed to the world at a mere 20 years old.
You're still getting your vision.
I am still getting my vision. My vision is, I don't know.
Yeah.
I think it's just a different like regional culture. I feel like a lot of the cons here, by the panels they select, a lot of times I feel like they do gear themselves to being for a more immature audience. So there's definitely there can definitely be a more immature atmosphere here in North Carolina than there would be at AWA. They just kind of, you know, shovel that away.
Does anybody else have any thoughts on panels though? Because if not, I think we should move into like guests. So yeah, the guests were all pretty noteworthy this year. I met Team Four Star, which was just a dream for me. And they gave me a shirt and signed a Goku pop, and that was awesome. I also saw Chris Niosi, who is the voice of Therion. He signed my collector's edition of Octopath Traveler on the fold-out page for Therion, and he lost his mind because he didn't know this was a thing. So he just got so excited and started flipping through it like a child, and it was so fun to watch. And I also had a couple interactions with Jon Swasey, who is basically anime dad. He's voiced every anime dad that you could possibly think of. He's Lord Death, he's Gendo, he's Hohenheim, he's a couple of others that I can't think of at the moment. Yeah, those were the highlights for me. What were some of the guests that you guys liked to see?
I didn't really pay attention to any of the guests. I mean, the only people that I was interested in seeing were, Dave and Daryl, because, I mean, I listen to AWO often, off and on, and they're sort of like the, you know, old Taku Jesus, I guess.
Yeah, they're not really guests, but they really kind of are.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Their personalities.
Yeah.
Yes.
But, yeah, I didn't care about any guests. They didn't. I mean, they had some Japanese people, but nothing that I personally really cared about. They had a lot of bands, which was really cool. I don't spend a lot of time going to concerts at conventions. And I'm just going to be honest, American voice actors don't do it for me.
Gotcha.
Yeah, usually I don't freak out over too many voice actors and actresses, especially with like Japanese dubbing, because I'm not a purist, I swear. I watch the subs usually because the series usually comes out and subbed first. And then they get to dub. So by then, I've already gotten embedded into the subbed version. Mm-hmm. But I was so happy. One of the first people they announced for Ewa was the voice actress for Brigitte from Overwatch, and I freaked out. This is her second con appearance. I got her to sign an Overwatch board poster thing that my friend got me for my birthday. And I'm hoping to get a handful more when we go to Momo this spring, so it'll be more on the board. But I was like, you're the first one to sign it, and she was really happy about that. She was super sweet and really adorable. But yeah, that was really the only voice actor that I actually got to sign anything. I was more happy and freaking out over the fact that one of my favorite webcomic artists was in the artist alley. Lucid is wonderful. If you like anything BL related, she has one of the best webcomics ever out there. Check her out. She's great. I went and I thankfully didn't fall into a puddle of mush when I met her. I managed to compose myself and I was like, thank you so much. Hi, I'm a Patreon. I've been following you since like chapter 2. We're on chapter 5 now. Following this girl forever. So I was like, I am meeting her and I've wanted to meet her forever. And I wasn't certain if I was ever going to go to a con that she would go to, and she was there.
Nice.
And she's great. And
wonderful. Well, that's good.
So that was my main fangirl moment, was meeting her at the convention.
That's good.
And then I scuttled off, and yeah.
So nobody else really cared for the guests besides the two of us then?
Doesn't seem I was like a little busy working.
Yeah, I know you were working. Well... Yeah, some of the guests were a little expensive also. Like, I know we all had planned to get a few things signed by higher profile voice actors, but they were all charging like $30 per signature, and we were not about that. So the only thing I paid to get signed was my copy of Final Fantasy 15 by the guy who plays Noctis, because it's Noctis.
Mm-hmm.
But besides that,
back. All right.
Yeah, pretty much.
Yep.
And it was a steelbook, and he signed it in gold pen, and it looks absolutely beautiful. So
this is awesome.
Yeah. But besides that, they were still really cool guests. Like, I talked to a couple of them when I was getting just smaller things signed, and they were all just really nice people. And that's one of the things I like, is always meeting the talent and just talking to them about how, like, certain things they've done, or like just what it's like to be a voice actor, because that always interested me. I just never actually got into being one personally. So it's cool to kind of live vicariously through meeting them. But yeah, if that's it about guests, we can go ahead and move into the dealer's room then. Okay. I can speak for myself in saying that I thought that this dealer's room / artist alley was easily the highest quality I've ever been to. Like, there was nothing that was just like, why is this artist here? They have three prints. Or like, this guy is blatantly selling everything is bootleg. And I didn't see any of that here. And I was like really happy about that. Like, anybody else have thoughts on that?
Yeah, I can concur with that. I don't recall seeing anything. I don't recall seeing anything bootleg. I don't recall seeing anything too special either. I mean, like, Otaku Joe's always has like something good, but nothing was next level or something I hadn't seen before. And I didn't buy that much, and which is surprising for me because I often buy way too much at conventions. But I only bought like one figure. I bought a couple straps. Bought a couple laid back camp stuff. But I just enjoyed walking through it, because like oftentimes like the dealer's room is a place for me to kill time.
Oh yeah.
And I'm
sure.
Like waiting for something, or like everybody else is doing something, and I'm just kicking it, walking around. So like I'll just go to the dealer's room and walk around and look at figures that I shouldn't buy and that I can't buy.
It's nice to just look.
Yeah, it's great to just look, because that's why you're at a convention. You're there to look. But there was one guy who had some cool laser discs. Otaku Joe had some cool laser discs. I think Edwin bought two volumes of Bubblegum Crisis on Laserdisc. He had one copy, I think it was like volume 2 of Nadia, which I thought about buying for a minute, and then I didn't. But other than that, there's some Lupin stuff, a lot of Urusei Yatra stuff. In terms of old stuff, in terms of new stuff, there was Infinite Love Live and Idolmaster. I bought the only Bandori figure that I saw, and there was one Gachapon that had Bandori keychains in it. And that was the only things from Bandori that I saw. Couple laid back camp stuff, but just a general like sort of good mix of a bunch of stuff. So it was it was a big dealer's room, had like artists in one half and then dealers in the other. And then in the back left, they had all the waifu cars, which was nice.
Yeah. They also had all the autograph booths tucked in the back of the dealer's room, which was kind of nice. And they had that old timey soda place stuck up in the front, which always caused a backup because everybody was trying to get refills.
Oh, and they had the banana pit that Mike Tool jumped in.
Yes. Yeah.
Oh my god. I really regret not bringing my banana suit, because I could have gotten the greatest picture of banana in the banana pit.
We need to all cosplay banana at a con one time.
We've been talking about that for so long and just have never actually done it.
We'll have to commit. We have to commit.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
So, John, I know you were working, but did you actually get any chance to take a break and go spend money frivolously?
I did, actually. I was with Andrew at the Gachapons. Okay. I had gotten... I went twice. I was trying to get one of the Eevee Gachapons. Ended up getting Jolty on the first time, Eevee the second time. I also got a No-Face from Spirited Away, the fan.
All
which
right.
is kind of cool.
Okay.
And I got a little teacup that had Eevee on it as well. And I feel like I got one other thing.
Wait, what do you mean? It was like one of the figures that's like Eevee in the teacup, or a teacup with Eevee on it?
Yeah, it's a teacup that has Eevee on it, and it's more like a cup you'd use to drink like green tea with, that kind of thing.
Okay, that's cool.
Yeah, yeah. So I only got those four things, if I'm not mistaken. But I found some pretty good stuff there.
Tobias, what about you?
Well, I didn't buy too much. I picked up the Space Patrol Lilico Blu-rays. You need to get that. I half-heartedly looked for Fujiko Mine on Blu-ray because it's now out of print, but I couldn't find it.
Really?
It just went out of print like a week ago. They announced that the license has expired specifically, so I want to get it before it becomes ungettable.
It's probably a job for the internet.
I didn't look too hard for it. I kind of half-hearted look. But specifically, the swag that I got for the most part was actually a big gift from Austin, which I want to give him a shout out, even though my good son couldn't make it to the podcast tonight. He did give me a substitute son. I actually have my own port now, so I don't have
Yay!
To
work.
He also got me, when he was in Japan, he went to one of the like anime museums they have there in Tokyo. And they had a Golden Kamuy exhibit, so he got me some cool Golden Kamuy merch. He gave me, I guess it would just be like a Genga. It's not really a cell; it's just like a Genga picture of one of the one of the frames from Golden Kamuy. Also got a little hand towel with the good boy Shiraishi on it, best character. he got me a volume one of Kill la Kill at his local store. So I didn't buy a whole bunch, but I got a bunch of stuff for free.
That's good. Always nice.
Yeah, that's the best. One thing I do want to mention in the dealer's room, though, as you talked about, you have the cars, the Itachi cars in the back corner. The autographs were well in the back, but also sort of made you walk through the convention center to get to it.
Yeah.
Walk through the dealer's room to kind of encourage people to buy stuff. Yeah, I didn't spend any time in the artist alley this year. But one thing that they did this year that was really interesting was, and this was true for much of the convention center, they always had stages everywhere with music happening.
Yeah, that was so cool.
So they had like the one Anisong guy like in the corner of the duo's room. They had one in the food court. I'm pretty sure there was one in the cosplay atrium as well. So it was wild to see like four or five stages spread out throughout, just full of musical acts.
Yeah, that one in the food court you're talking about, they were up and going at like
Sunday.
10 a.m.
Yeah,
on Sunday,
like rocking out to like the Dororara opening.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, we were listening to the songs from like 6 years ago, and like Tobias and I are just sitting there trying to have our subway. Yeah, oh man.
Yeah, the DJs were really cool. It gave a good atmosphere to the con. Like it felt fun. It felt really fun.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
The only thing I had to complain about was if you went down to the food court, you had to walk like half a mile to get back into the con.
Yeah, because they had the escalator was down all weekend. That sucked.
Yeah.
That was unfortunate.
They had that lower level little mall area open essentially to the general public because there's still stores in there. So.
I think they probably would have had somebody checking badges on the up escalator if you like were going to go back to the con, but it wasn't the biggest deal. It was just kind of a minor inconvenience, but circling back to the dealer's room real quick, Marisa, I know you got quite a few things.
Okay. So I'm just going to make mention of the Artist Alley again. Artist Alley is usually where I spend most of my money because I love just a lot of fan merch, especially with prints. It's really nice. If I usually spend anything, it's there because a lot of official merch can be like way too expensive, and you're like, "Do I really need that Blu-ray?" Nah. Mm-hmm. But there is one artist besides obviously Elucid, who is wonderful. There was an artist who I walked like when I walked past him, I was like, "Oh my gosh, I recognize your art!" Like they did a bunch of art of like the Robins from. DC, and I was like, oh my gosh, I've seen this on the internet, and especially in the small world that is the Bat Boys, and just in general, like art's not very hard easy to come by. So I'm like, I recognize these artists, and I bought a ton of Tim merch from them. because Tim is best Robin and needs love. And I talked to them for a little while because they were great. And then the curse that import dealer. There's a dealer.
Oh, yeah.
A bunch of idle import stuff. And I'm with you, Andrew. It's hard to find any merch of like this one series, which is Idolish 7. They're still probably more popular than Bandori.
That guy. Oh.
There's so much Love Live. I was like, if only I was in the Love Live fandom. I'm in Idolish 7 hell and crying because there's next to nothing. But I got a handful of merch of my good boy Iori so I could make my bag. And then I was like, oh, look, they have the first album for a really decent price. And it comes with a little hand towel. This hand towel is it's a big towel. Like this sucker's huge. And it came with a pin light and a photo book as well. So it was a really nice little set for the first year anniversary album that they released. So mine, because it's really hard to find official albums of Idolish 7.
But that was both of us went a little crazy in the dealer's room this year. I'm normally with you. I normally only spend money in the artist alley, but I recently hit a point where my wall literally cannot hold any more art. There's just no room. So I'm taking a break. Yeah. Well, I bought a Fire Emblem print because I never find Fire Emblem. So I was like, you know what? I'm going to get this one. And it's really good. And I like it. And it's like $10. So I got a Fire Emblem print. And the import dealer that Marisa mentioned, he kind of broke me.
Oh, no. He broke you more than he broke me. Like,
oh, yeah. I found.
Could have gone worse.
Oh, I could have gone worse, too. I just held back. I found the Persona 5 OST, like, physically. And I really wanted to get that. I wound up not getting that because instead I found Kingdom Hearts 1 Final Mix Platinum Edition, Kingdom Hearts 2 Final Mix, and Kingdom Hearts Birth by Sleep Final Mix. So I bought all those. As I am walking to check out, I see this red little thing catch my eye, and lo and behold, it is a boxed copy of Mother 3.
Yeah, saw that.
I was so excited. I bought that thing instantly, and I put back the Persona soundtrack in order to like balance out the fact I was buying a boxed copy of Mother 3. And yeah, so that guy got a decent chunk of money from me. I also got like a couple volumes of manga and just little things here and there that not really worth mentioning. But
you're gonna mention your son.
Oh, of course I'm gonna mention my son. I'm getting there. The funniest thing about the Kingdom Hearts Final Mix Platinum Edition is it's a collector's edition that was only released in Japan. So, you know how Austin just went to Japan?
Yeah.
Yeah, that boy and I are not talking right now because I show him what I get and I'm so proud of it because I got it for a good price too, you know, relatively speaking. And he's just like, wow. Two things. One, good find. I'm so happy you found this. Two, you're gonna hate me because I found this exact same thing in Japan, and guess how much I paid for it? He paid $8. I did not pay $8.
Oh, man.
So I was very upset with Austin, except, you know, he found it in Japan, so I can't really hold that against him. But probably my favorite thing that I found is, so story time real quick. Marissa and I went into the artist alley and I was like, I'm only looking for like two things. One, anything involving my son, again, Rowlet. And two, anything with Fire Emblem. I found Fire Emblem and I was like, now I just need to find something with Rowlet. And we walked past this one guy who had some boob mouse pads. And I was like, you know, I actually kind of want a new mouse pad. However, the boobs are tacky. So I don't want like a boob mouse pad, but I want a mouse pad with art because I like these. They're really cool, but I just don't like those because they're tacky and I don't want anime titty on my desk. So we're just kind of, I'm just kind of like, yeah, I don't know. Maybe I'll find something, but I doubt it. About three or four booths down, Marissa just grabs me and is just like, look. And I look down, and there is a mouse pad of Decidueye with two Rowlets at the bottom that serve as the boobs. So I found a Rowlet Boob mouse pad.
Because that's how Pokemon morphology works, right?
It's like kind of like they're in a nest, and yeah, like the Decidueye is just kind of overlooking them, but they're like the two
that's
little
how they reproduce.
I know. The two little raised lumps are two Rowlets. And so I told the artist the story, and I was just like, I'm buying this from you, and here's why. And she's just like, yeah, this doesn't have boobs. It has hooters. Wow. And I just handed her the money and walked away.
I don't need change. Just take it.
Yeah. It was so funny, though. Like, I'm so happy with this thing. It looks beautiful. It works great. And my wrist does not want to kill me anymore. So, yeah, that was my experience with the dealer's room. I spent a lot of money, but in my defense, I also made a lot of money at the Super Happy Fun Sale, so I think it balances out.
Well, that's good.
Yep. So, yeah. Overall, what did you guys think of the con, starting with John? What did you think? I know you volunteered a lot, so you probably have very different thoughts than the rest of us.
I mean, it was still fun. We had a lot of issues as far as tech went, but it was still very fun and enjoyable. Still got to see a lot of the panels that you guys were running. I know I dipped into, what was it? It was Daryl's, he had a lot of clips together. Andrew, what was that panel where there were just, it had the long, long man commercials.
Oh man.
Do you remember?
Panel Doom, yeah.
Yeah, but I got to see a little bit of the panel of Doom. That was funny. I thoroughly enjoyed that. But yeah, I mean, good people. I had a lot of fun. I'm going to do it again next year.
You got to pick one favorite moment from this weekend. What was it?
Favorite moment of the weekend? Oh my God.
What was your favorite thing that you did?
Favorite thing that I did? Probably working with Enda again, just because he's gay, and he's got his either boyfriend or husband there. I'm not really sure, but they're really cute together, and we flirt all the time on the job. It's just great and it's funny. We just have a good working chemistry, and it's always enjoyable. I mean, he taught me how to use the light system he had there for like 2 hours.
Oh wow!
On Saturday, so like. Fun guy. I really hope to run into him again sometime next year. Hopefully more than just once. But as far as like what I did on my own, that was probably like my most enjoyable thing, just working with him again.
Gotcha. Well, that's fun. Andrew, what about you? How'd you general thoughts and favorite part of the weekend?
Well, yeah, this was my first time going, and even though like I didn't really get to plan for it too much in advance, and I didn't get to go for the whole con, I I'm hooked. Like, I can't not go.
I know, right?
Like, it was just like a tremendous amount of fun and like a tremendous amount of like different stuff that you just don't get to see. And I think the highlight for me was in Daryl's panel of Doom was the German safety video.
Oh man.
For the forklift, and I had not seen that before. Tobias looked at me and he said, "Have you seen this?" And I was like, "No, I haven't." He was like, "Oh my God, you haven't seen this?" And so then I watched that, and that was thoroughly enjoyable. And of course, Long Long Man, the entire Long Long Man saga was very,
oh,
very
so great.
Yeah, so I can't not go. So it's probably going to be, you know, an obligatory trip from here on out. And since it's going to be later in the year next year, it's, what is it, October?
I think it's like, oh, it's 20. Yeah, I thought it was like Halloween weekend or something.
Oh, yeah, that is Halloween.
Yeah,
weekend.
It's the 30th. Yeah, it's the October 30th through November 1st, I think.
Yeah,
we're going to have to go in cosplay next year for sure then.
Yeah, there's going to be probably some sick Halloween parties. But yeah, I think at this point, you know, I mean, kind of like how Austin was spoiled with Japan. Like, he didn't go into the dealer's room and really buy anything because he was like, oh, man, all this stuff's too expensive. You know? But, like, I don't know. It's in the top tier of cons I've been to, certainly. Because, I mean, you just don't get stuff like you get at AWA in North Carolina. So, yeah,
for sure.
Absolute 100% go all the time for me.
Tobias, I think you probably share that sentiment, right?
Yeah, so I think my best favorite part of the weekend is honestly pretty much what Andrew just said. Like, I've been in this con for a long time. I know what it's like. But I really enjoy like sharing that experience with like, you know, my friends and, you know, my pseudo family, like you guys. So, you know, like Austin and, you know, Tori showed up last year. You know, Tori had been there before, but Austin was brand new. And to sort of spark that, like, that interest in this grand new convention experience, like, in them, and to have them say, like, you know, we're coming back for sure next year. Like, that was really great. And even with John, too. Like, John, you kind of had the same, you know, thoughts last year with volunteering. That you had a really crazy fun time. Mm-hmm. And so like, when we planned this year, like more of us going, like I was really hyped to like introduce all of you guys to this experience as well. And so like my gift is really like hearing you guys just like validate that, like wanting to come back next year, wanting to make it a regular thing. You know, when you know, Andrew decided to show up last minute, you know, you asked me if I had a hotel room. Like I didn't even hesitate. Like, yes, you were going to be in my hotel room. Whatever we can do to get you to come, like you are going to be here. And yeah, to see you enjoy, like, you know, Totally Lame and Anime Hell, just like I was introduced to it all those years back, to watch Panel of Doom, you know, to be able to like hobnob like we did and hang out with these, you know, maybe not guests on the schedule, but pretty much these important people in our own, mm-hmm. you know, personal fan lives, like to share that love of this grand event. You know, I say it every year, but like AWA is like my one convention. This is my church. And I've said it before, like Anime Hell, going to Anime Hell every year for the past 14 years, that's honestly the most consistent thing I've ever done in my adult life.
So like, Anime Hell is basically your mass service?
That's my mecca. Like,
so you didn't actually go to the actual anime mass service then?
Oh, no. The whole Vic, it was it. I don't think Vic was there this year, but usually just kind of... no, but like, I mean, I've moved states, I've moved around, like I've got different jobs, you know, I've like changed friend groups and you know, people like that. But like going to Anime Hell and going to ABA is the most consistent thing that I've done in my young adult life. And yeah, like it's nice to have that validated by being like you guys, and to meet new people, to be introduced to new people, to see the same people year after year that I only see in Atlanta, Georgia, that one weekend in September. It's a really great experience.
That's great. And Marissa, I know this was your first time like mine, so what were your general thoughts for a first timer and favorite moment?
I definitely enjoyed this con a lot. As I mentioned before, comparing it to like AZ, which is the biggest convention that we have here in North Carolina, it blew my expectations. I was talking to a friend of mine on the way down, and she was like, I'm really happy that you're going to AWA and eventually Momo. It's like, they're much better conventions. She's like, AWA is one of my favorite cons. She's like, it's great. It's a big con, but it doesn't feel like it. The community is great. And I wasn't disappointed at all. She was completely correct. And I think another reason why I think I enjoyed it so much was, well, it was really fresh. I was seeing a lot of new faces, a lot of new things, new panels. There wasn't anything stale. But at the same time, I really hope that AWA doesn't become like Jibon Con or AZ, where it starts to get a little more like, okay, I've seen the same things over and over again. But I hope it stays fresh and new and fun throughout like the rest of my time that I'm planning on going to this con. I'd have to say my favorite moment is, I've already mentioned this before, is meeting Lucid. I never would have thought I would get to meet her. She mostly goes to Northeast cons or cons over in like, more north, like Oda, Katsu, and stuff like that. So I never felt like I was going to be able to meet her unless I went to one of those conventions, but I didn't want to go out of my way too much. Even though I've heard good things about Katsu, and I heard, past tense, heard good things about Otakon, this was a last minute thing for her going to AWA. She did a ton of conventions this spring, going to things like Katsu and Otakon, and was kind of burnt out. Then all of a sudden I notice she posts a picture, like fan art of Banana Fish, and she's like, yeah, I'm going to be selling this print at AWA. And I was like, wait, what? And I look on her Twitter, which I never check Twitter, and she's like, yeah, going to AWA last minute con. And I'm like, I actually get to meet her. And I was internally sobbing, and
you were not internally anything.
I was squeeing, but I managed to hold it in. Like you said, I didn't melt or puddle. I managed to actually.
Oh no, you held it in when you met her. You were not internally screaming when you found out.
No, I was not internally screaming when I found out. But I got to talk to her, and I was really happy that I got to tell her that she's a wonderful artist, and that I'm here supporting her pretty much for all of her endeavors, for all of her wonderful webcomics that she has currently going and planned in the future. So, yeah, and she was really touched by it. She's like, oh my gosh, thank you so much. And I told her, actually, that I've been reading her comic essentially since, like, chapter one, beginning of chapter two, which is really a long time ago. Like, this is early, it would be about like 2013-ish or so. I've been reading this. I don't know how I found it. She was like, wait, what? You've been reading it for that long? I'm like, yeah, I have. And she's like, wow, thank you so much. I don't think I've met anyone who's been reading it for that long. I'm like, yeah, no, I've been here lurking in the corner for a couple of years. So yeah,
she gave you a pin for being such a loyal fan, too.
She did. And then I bought a handful of other merch from her because I'm going to make an Ida bag for her series, because those boys are great. It's like a good story.
Yeah.
So it's definitely not for most people. It is 18 plus, and it is boy love. So if you don't like that, don't read it. But she's great. She's wonderful.
Yeah. But yeah, for me too, overall, like, I just absolutely love the con. It was a fun road trip with my friends. Got to bring Will and Edwin too, and they were both like blown away at just how awesome it was. They had a ton of fun. So did I. I've never spent this much money in a dealer's room before, so this is definitely going to be a once in a while type deal for me. But probably favorite moment was like, just I really can't pick one. And yeah, that's hypocritical of me because I asked each of you to pick one. But I met Team Four Star, who's like, they've been my idols for like ever. I love them. I quote Nail all the time. Sorry, no, I quote Guru saying Nail all the time.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I ran panels. They went really well. Our Batman in Japan one went better than I could have ever imagined it would go. I found so much stuff that I just absolutely love, and I just had a great time overall. So, like, if I had to narrow it down, though, I would probably actually say Video Game Hell, because I've never really been to an 18-plus panel that really appealed to me before, because at Ichi and Triad, they're all, like, kind of just edgy. Fandom stuff. Yeah, edgy.
Edgy.
Yeah, and it was a ton of fun. We had a lot of fun, watched some really funny videos at like 1 o'clock in the morning, and it inspired me to do my own. So
mm-hmm.
Yeah, I'll probably give it to that, but it was just so much fun. Like, I definitely can say we're all going to be going back.
Yep.
I really hope that the change in weekend doesn't like affect schedules like next year, but I don't see it personally happening for me, but that's also a year away, so we don't have to worry about mm-hmm. that right now.
That's true.
But yeah, does anybody have any final thoughts? Because I think we're about ready to wrap up.
It was awesome, and I can't wait to do it again.
Well said.
Especially with this group of people right here.
Yep.
You were listening to this podcast, and go to AWA next year.
That's yes. true. Even if you're not listening to this podcast, go to AWA next year.
You can get our autographs, and we will not charge you for them.
Yeah, nope. all these people that I bought things from kept asking me for my autograph. Like, they would just hand me a slip of paper and be like, hey, can you sign this? And I'd be like, I mean, yeah, I guess.
Oh, okay, you were using your card.
Stupid joke.
Wow.
Yeah, but yeah, thanks for joining us. We had a ton of fun at AWA, and we cannot wait to do it again next year. So.
Mm-hmm.
From those of us at Third Impact, the takeaway from this weekend is you can get a mouse pad with boobs that is not tacky. That is the one thing to take away from this weekend.
Mm-hmm. It has Hooters.
It has Hooters.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
It's classy.
I have one last thing to say.
All right.
Long, long, man.
I think we'll just cut it there.
Yep.
All right. Thanks for joining us, everybody.